Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Better than that. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
All right, got it. Happy Resurrection Day.
Amen. Amen.
And before we start the regular service, I'd like to sing a piece for you called "He's Alive," and it's told from the point of view of Peter as he becomes aware of the fact that Jesus is risen. If you're reading over the last couple of days the account of Jesus suffering and death and everything, it was kind of ironic. The disciples didn't remember that he had told them, "I'm going to rise again." But the chief priests and elders and scribes, who hated him 100%, went to Pilate and said, "We remember that this imposter said he was going to rise again." So the irony was pretty funny. I don't know what I would have felt like if I had been one of those elders of Israel, and it all of a sudden looked out my window and seen Jesus walking after the resurrection. I think I would have just passed out. We were wrong, you know. But anyway, I'd like to sing this piece entitled "He's Alive."
Amen.
Gates and doors were barred, and all the windows fastened down. Sleeplessness knows every sound. Half in homeless sorrow, half in fear of the day, to find the soldiers breaking through and drag us all away. Just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The game began to rattle. Voice began to call. Hurried to the window, looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. There was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said they moved him in the night, and none of us knows where.
He's alive. He's alive. He's alive.
Amen.
And Erin's going to be playing Christ the Lord is Risen Today. Now, this is the third time we've done this because Judy and Vicki and I played it, and then we sang it, and now she's going to play it. But in light of the tremendous truth there is, you can never hear it enough.
Yes, sir.
This morning, musically, we're going to ask you to walk with us as we go from Good Friday to Resurrection.
Thank you.
Happy Resurrection Day. It's good to see everyone here this morning. We welcome the visitors that are here, that are worshiping with us this morning. We're so glad you're here. I hope the Lord blesses your heart this very wonderful day that we have. This is the day the Lord has made. We rejoice. We're glad in it. You know, although that we don't see Him, we love Him. Although that we don't see Him now, we believe in Him. And we are filled with an inexpressible and a glorious joy because we are receiving the goal of our salvation through our faith in Him. Isn't that a wonderful thing? We're here today as we're the body of Christ. God's presence is here with us also. Amen?
Amen.
We just want to acknowledge that. And I'm going to ask Brian, he's going to blow the shofar horn. And one day we shall hear this, and I want you to hear this, a wonderful sound.
Did you say one thing?
Sure, go ahead, my brother.
I've been doing this a couple years now, and during seminar service. Anyway, the Lord posed the question to me, why do I do it? And that was a good question to be asked, for sure. We talked about the feasts, Israel's feasts, and we spoke about when, like Jesus, when he died at Passover, and then when he was resurrected, it was first fruits. And then the next feast to come was the Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Pentecost, 50 days. So that's when the Holy Spirit came. And then the next feast is Tabernacles, which is when the Israelites went around in the wilderness, like we are. Those that are saved, we're in these earthen bodies, but soon we will be with the Lord. So the next one to come is the Feast of Trumpets. And we see in Revelations, it says the angels will blast the horns, and the dead in Christ will rise first, and then we who are left alive will be caught up in the air with them. So that's why I blow it.
Amen.
Because it's a reminder that someday that horn's going to sound, and we're going to leave this earth and be with our Lord.
So praise the Lord.
I don't plan on raising any dead today.
At least I hope.
All right. Let's see. Does anybody know what a shofar sounds like?
You will now.
Excellent. You don't know, I'm doing it right now.
You know, this week I was experienced a funeral service. I experienced a wedding. The two great parallels of what we experience in life. There's the sad times in life, and then there's the times of when we can rejoice and marriage. But when a Christian dies, it's sad that we lose the loved one. It's sad that we will not have someone tangible to touch, but we have the blessed hope of knowing that they're with the Lord. To be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. We can have that comfort and that joy. So if you're a Christian, we'll be reunited with our loved ones. You see, Jesus Christ, He came to this earth, He died on the cross, and He rose again on the third day. And that ratified what God has said in His Word. That was the signature that what God declared would be so. Aren't you glad that we have that? Aren't you glad that we're able to look back at what Jesus had done and walk today in the resurrection power if you've been born from above? And I hope and pray that through this service, as we share through God's Word, we will understand the resurrection of the body is a wonderful thing. Amen? It's a eternal life for us, and one day we'll get rid of this. I don't know if you have aches and pains and you drag these bodies around. I know that I do. There's just comfort in that I'm going to get rid of those. But the greatest thing is that I'm going to be in Almighty God's presence. I'm going to be in the presence of God. And I can't wait until that day. The Apostle Paul says it like this. He says, you know, to live is Christ and to die is gain. And you would say, well, you know, how would you like to go to a funeral? And you always hear this, sorry about your loss. But the Apostle Paul says, it's to gain. So when you die, you don't lose, you gain. And when we have the right perception of things, you know, this is only a temporary place. Although, you know, we waste away outwardly day by day. We are being renewed inwardly day by day. Because of the light and momentary troubles that you have, they just achieve for us an eternal glory that far outweighs this temporal here. So that's why I fix your eyes on not what's seen. Because when you look at what's seen, it's only temporary. But what is unseen is eternal, you see? And that's why we're blessed with our faith of knowing that there is a future beyond right here. Amen? Jesus took the sting out of death. Hallelujah. We may face the dying of his body, but your spirit lives on. And Jesus took that sting out, so there's no longer any fear. There's a verse in the book of Hebrews that says this, that since the children have flesh and blood, he too had flesh and blood, so that he's able to deliver us from the one who held the power over death, and that was the devil, who were held all their life by the fear of death. See, if you're a Christian, you should not have fear of death today, because Jesus took the sting out of it. Amen? It reminds me of a story that there was a young boy. He was about 12 to 13 years old, and he was deathly allergic to bee stings. And he was riding along with his father in the car, and there was a wasp that got into the car. And the little boy started to panic, and the father grabbed the bee, and without the boy's knowing it, took the stinger out. And then he let the bee go on. And his son started to go into great panic again, because he thought if he got bitten by this bee, this allergic reaction would come, and he would lose his breath. The father says, I've taken the sting out. See, Jesus took the stinger out for us. You see, you may experience the things in this life, but Jesus took the sting out of death. Amen? There's no fear any longer for us to die. I don't know about you, but I say hallelujah to that. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise his name. This is a resurrection day that we celebrate. And it's been celebrated ever since the first century. And you know that the disciples didn't understand it all at once. That's why I quoted that scripture. Although that we don't see him, we love him. And although that we don't see him now, we believe in him. But we're filled with an inexpressible and a glorious joy that we have because of the spirit that God places within us. You see? And those first century disciples, the day that Mary Magdalene went to the tomb, and I just love that, you know. Who was the first? A woman, right? And it was a woman that Jesus had driven out seven demons. You see, when you come in contact with the Lord, the old has passed and the new has come. He removes all the faulty things of man, and he gives us new life. Guess why? Because he gives us his life. He lives, and we also live, because he lives within inside of us. You see, so Mary Magdalene, she's at the tomb with the other women, and she didn't see the body. She ran back to tell Peter and tell John, and they ran to the tomb, and John was singing that song earlier. And it's interesting, I guess, how we depict in the scripture John had to be the younger because he outran Peter. I don't know, I, regardless of old men can run too, they think. But they came to the tomb, and Jesus was not there, and from all that Christ had been speaking to them, the 3 years that he ministered here on earth, and they walked with him, and they talked with him, and they saw the miracles, and on that Good Friday, all of everything came to a culmination, and great disappointment must have flooded into their lives, wouldn't you think? All their hopes and dreams were nailed there on the cross. They were put to death, all their hopes and their dreams, until Sunday came, amen? And when Sunday came, there was a new beginning, there was a resurrection, there was the power of God that came upon our Lord and raised him from the dead. And although he was raised from the dead, he was now seen by many. He was seen by believers. The Bible says over 500 at one time. He went and he saw Peter and then James. And the women also testify to this message that he is now alive. All that they were afraid that had happened there on the Good Friday, now all hopes and dreams flooded back. Hallelujah. Because what I'm saying, you may weep for the night, my friend, but joy cometh in the morning. You might have lost loved ones. You might be grieving right now, but joy is coming in the morning. There's going to be a time where the resurrection is going to take place, where we're going to be joyous and we're going to celebrate. And that's why we're here today, to give thanks and praise. We call things that are not as if it's already has happened. Amen? And so it's already going to take place, so we're calling it today for the resurrection day that'll happen in the future for all of us. What a wonderful thing. But you know, we need to be reminded of this. We need to be reminded all the time. Although that you may know these things, we find in the scripture, Peter says, I thought that I should remind you of them. And the text that I chose this morning is found in 1 Corinthians in the 15th chapter. It's called the resurrection chapter. The type of bodies that we are going to receive. But Paul starts out in the scripture here of what is most important, of first importance. Because the death, burial, resurrection is the pinnacle of our faith. Is it not? That's the most important part of Christianity. And if we forget those things, if we're just a coffee-clutching club, per se, and not proclamating the gospel is what has power, my friends. I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation for those who believe. That's what the Bible says. And so when the gospel is spoken, it is not because of anything that I may say, but it is the very word of God. He sends forth his word, and he lays forth healing. It is the power of God speaking. You see? And God lays comfort to us, to knowing that we have a future that holds in his hands. He took the sting out of death and in the fear of dying. It reminds me of another story of a young man who had bone cancer at a very young age. And they knew he was not going to live. And his mother would go into the room, and he was so afraid. He said, Mommy, what will it be like when I die? Because he knew he was going to die. And the mother, which was a Christian, so distraught, went into the bathroom, got on her knees and said, God, what do I tell my son? What do I comfort him with? He's asking, what will it be like when I die? And she got a revelation, and I believe it from the Lord, and she went back and talked to her son and said, it'll be like this, son. Do you know when we travel on family destinations and you get tired in the car? And when we get home and you fall asleep in the car and Daddy picks you up in his arms and he places you in the bed and you wake in the bed in the morning, you don't know how you got from the car to the bed. It'll be the same way as your Heavenly Father comes and scoops you up and takes you to the heavenly home that he has prepared for you. The Bible says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Jesus was saying that to the disciples, and he says it to us now. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. If it were not so, I would tell you so, that I'm going now to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house is many mansions. Isn't that a wonderful thing? And if he goes before us, he says he'd come back to take us to be where he is at. Now, whether that is up taken in the rapture or we die of a natural death, but know this, if you're a Christian, the first thing you will see is Jesus, the one who died for us. His pierced wrist and his pierced in his side. The punishment that was upon the Lord Jesus Christ, he was crushed for our iniquities, and the punishment that brought us peace was upon him. It was by his stripes and by his wounds we are healed. All of us are like sheep, have gone astray. All of us have fallen short of the glory of God. But Jesus took the sin of humanity upon himself. He knew no sin, born of a virgin. And God placed all the sin on him and ratified by raising him from the dead. You and I can take comfort that our sins have been fully forgiven if you trusted what Jesus Christ has done. And if you trust the Lord Jesus Christ, what he has done on Calvary, ratifying by raising from the dead, on the third day, you are saved, and your hope is heaven, and you have a home that he's prepared for you. Hallelujah. Isn't that a wonderful thing? Isn't that a wonderful thing? But in the first century, the church starts birth. It's given birth, power of the Holy Spirit, day of Pentecost. And yet so quickly, the church departs from truth. And I just want to read you the first four verses in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 4. Look what he says here. The Apostle Paul talking to the church in Corinth. Corinth, by the way, could be a modern-day Atlantic City or modern-day America, you know. It's Babylon at its best, you know, where money is highly valued in gold and silver and lasciviousness, you know. There's immorality in all places, and what a place to birth a church, amen? That's why it's so amazing to see the first woman to the tomb was Mary Magdalene with seven demons driven out from her, amen? You see, that's why Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. Amen? The devil came to rob, kill, and destroy. He wants to destroy you, your family, your livelihood. He wants to steal your soul. You see? But Jesus came to destroy that work. Amen? Aren't you glad that he came to save us? The Bible says that he didn't come to condemn the world, but to save the world. And too many times, I don't know if it's the church that portrays of us looking down on others, but Jesus came for the whole world. He loved the world this much. This much. And we can't forget that message. And that's why the Apostle Paul, he wrote to the church this. He says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which ye also have received, and wherein ye stand, right? Verse 2, by which also you are saved, right? This is the gospel by where you stand, your foundation, and you are saved, he says. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. And what I tell you is what we hear, we want to receive here. Amen? The Bible says that if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, it's when we believe in our heart that we are indeed saved. Amen? And that's where we want the gospel to resonate in our heart, this truth about the resurrection. This truth that God had given us a Savior. But the first century church, again, was all types of idolatries and things that came in the city of Corinth. There were many Stoic philosophers, and that's why Paul says, do not be conformed or be held captive to any hollow and deceptive philosophy which depends on human tradition, basic principles of this world, rather than on Christ. You see, there are a lot of individuals that they're putting their lock, stock, and things on other things than Christ. It is Christ alone. We're saved by faith alone. And in Corinth, the philosophers thought that the body itself was evil. Now let me clarify something. When you hear the flesh in the Bible, and the flesh is in enmity with the spirit, it is not talking about this. It is the old nature when the Bible talks about the flesh. So it is not your body that is evil. The Stoic philosophers there in Corinth, they said that the body was evil. How could God come and live in the bodily form? And that's why you had those Gnostics and those that opposed the message of the death, burial, and resurrection. You understand what I'm saying? If there's a little bit of yeast gets in, it destroys the whole thing. If you are able to sow a seed of doubt, my friends, if you're able to have a half-truth. How many know that's not a truth at all? So, Paul wants to reiterate here. He says, for I delivered unto you, first of all, which I also have received, how Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. You see that verse 3? Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Do you know that He was handed over to death for our sins? He was handed over to death for our sins. And then the Bible says He was raised to life for our justification. Hallelujah. Justified, meaning just as we have not sinned. Hallelujah. That means clean slate. I don't know about you, but that is a wonderful thing to know, that we can have a clean slate starting here and now by trusting what Jesus did on Calvary. He was delivered over to death for our sins, acknowledging that we are sinners and we need saving. But then He was raised to life for our justification, just as if we had not sinned. And then it says, therefore we have peace with God, hallelujah, through our faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because otherwise, if you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we're in enmity with God. That means we're at war with God. I was at war with God for a long time. Believe me, I was brought up in a large denomination, and I went to church, and I did the ritual, and I recited scripture, but I was at war with God because I didn't have Christ in my heart. You see, I didn't trust Jesus and Jesus alone. I trusted myself until my scorecards read zero, until even the trap doors had another bottom. Some of you relate with that. There's no other answer. There's no other way. And you know what? I couldn't save myself. But Jesus said, come to me, all you are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. See, I was weary and I was burdened because I was trying to run life with myself. Trying to muddle through, per se. denying that, well, I shouldn't say I was denying that there was a God. I thought there was a God, but I thought that I was it. Come on, it may be funny, but that's the truth. We're all demigods. We have to take self off the throne and put God where he belongs. See, otherwise, we are just caught up in some tradition and hollow, deceptive philosophies which depend on things, basic principles of this world rather than on Christ. You see, it's supernatural salvation, amen? It is a supernatural spiritual experience going from death to life. That's what the Bible says. We go from death to life. Without Christ, we're walking in death. You said, well, Pastor Bob, I was walking, I had breath within me. Well, you know what? My greatest way to illustrate that is everyone gets a Christmas tree, right? And they cut it at the root. It still stays green for a while, doesn't it? But I'll tell you, that tree's dead. Right? Tree is dead. When the root is cut off, and see, all of us were born into sin and we were cut separate from God. We were God's enemy. And you may say, well, I was never an enemy with God, but when we refused to take the cure or the antidote that God had given to humanity, we deny what he had for us. We were in enmity with him. We were self-willed, run riot, running our own lives. But here's the blessing. Let me go back to the great side of it. God has the best for you. God has the greatest plan for you. He's your designer, amen? I love it when individuals, you know, they put aftermarket stuff on vehicles and so on like that. They think it's going to be a better product. Wrong. The manufacturer knows what's best for you. Amen? Did I lose anyone there? The designer, God, he knows what's best for us, right? But other times we try to live a life outside of God. We try to live our own lives. But he has the best for us. And the other portrayal is this. If I give my life to God, he's going to go ahead and rule over me, and he's just going to whip me into submission. No, he is a gentle, loving, merciful God that wants to have a relationship with us, wants to give you life and give you life abundantly. He wants you to have his joy placed in you. Not only joy for today, not only that you experience life and life abundantly today, but you have the hope of heaven. You have a future that God has planned for you. That is a wonderful thing. God loves families. God loves people. God sent his son to die for us. And there's this portrayal sometimes that God is mad at us. And I would ask for forgiveness if I ever portrayed the loving and merciful God that sent his son to die on the cross as someone that's mad at us. He loves us, and he's drawn us to himself and wants relationship with us. Paul reiterating here the foundation principles. For I delivered unto you first of all, which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. And look at verse 4. And that he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. You may say, Pastor, what do you mean according to the scripture? We didn't have the New Testament even written at that time. He's talking about Old Testament. Christ is the crimson thread from Genesis to Revelation. Jesus is in Genesis, my friends. Jesus is seen all through Scripture. When he's saying, according to the Scripture, that Christ was dead, buried, and resurrection, we see it in the Bible all the way from the beginning. It was God's plan from the beginning. If you notice, he says here in verse 3 again, he says, for I deliver unto you, first of all, which I also received. He didn't go to seminary to get that. If you look in the book of Galatians, it says that God revealed these truths to him himself. Amen? And that's why I pray and hope that the Holy Spirit speaks unto your heart, because the words of man won't do it. And if God's speaking to your heart this morning, you need to open your heart. Jesus says, I stand at the door and I knock. And if anyone who hears my voice and they open the door, I shall come in and sup with you and you with me. If you hear his voice this morning, our problem is if we keep Jesus on the outside. Our blessed evangelist, he gave us the portrayal of the painting of Jesus standing at the knocking of the door. And the door was painted and Jesus knocking. And he told us, he said that the knob was not on the outside, that the knob is on the inside. See, if you're going to let Jesus in, you have to open the door. And too many times we have Jesus crowded out. And if you leave the service today and you say, well, you know, I paid my penance and I came to church. Friend, it's not about a ritual. It's about a relationship that God loves you and he doesn't want you to be separate. I'm just a man. I'm just a man, but I pray, as the scripture says, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in God's sight. To formulate words that are eternal difference is a high, high, high call. You see? And if I would let you leave without sharing that truth, then on my hands, and I would face God, and he would say, why didn't you tell them the truth? Why didn't you tell them? If you're a Christian here this morning, it's just as what Paul said, I declare to you the gospel that I preached to you, which you also have received. I tell you this, I want to keep you in remembering, in memory, that Jesus died for our sins, and that he rose again on the third day. He is the first fruit from the dead. And next week, we're going to be going through the feast. And we'll see how the parallel of God's plan unfolds in Scripture. How undeniably from the Word of God, how God's Word be true and every man be a liar. This is God's inspired Word. It is useful for us for teaching, rebuking, and training in righteousness. That everything that was written in the past has been written to bring you encouragement so that you might have hope. You might have hope. Let me talk about a practical thing. I know we're running out of time, but you know, not only do we have a hope for a future, not only is there a hope for today, but God is concerned about our everyday lives. Many of us at times have ran from God because of disappointments in our lives. If God is there, why didn't he answer? If God is there, why did he allow? If God is there, he wouldn't have taken my loved one. And I know we've all gone through those type of thoughts at some times in our life. And God wants you to know that his ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. The heavens are much higher than the earth. And so, through faith and trust, God will bring the deliverance about in due time. Weeping might come for a night, but the joy is coming, my friends. There may be things that you have long buried. There may be dreams that you have given up on. But Jesus is still the resurrection. He says, I am the resurrection. Put your faith and trust in him. Father, I thank you for your word today. I thank you for the congregation, for those who have come out. And I pray, Lord God, whatever I have spoken here, Lord, I pray it may settle down on the heart and never to be uprooted again. And Lord God, again, I am just a man, Lord, delivering what I believe you have given me to share. An errand boy, a male boy. And so, God, I just pray that this is spoken in the hearts of men, and I pray a blessing upon them this Easter season as they go and join with their families, O Lord, with the hope that is set before them, Lord. Give them your peace, grant them with that. And Lord, we thank you. I thank you for each one who's come out, for each family they represent. Father, you know the hairs on our head and every need in our heart. And so bless each one today, Father, with your presence throughout this day. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.